Good evening, dear past presidents, council members, relations of engineer Vimal Surendra, members and guests. You all are welcome to engineer DJ Vimal Surendra memorial oration. Kindly rise for presidential procession, please. I kindly request following distinguished personnel to light the traditional oil lamp. Engineer Professor T.M. Pallavatta, President IESL. Engineer Professor Sam Karunaratna, Past President IESL. Engineer B.R. Fernando, Past President IESL. Engineer D.G. Rienzi Fernando, the guest speaker today. Representative of the family of late Engineer D.J. Vimal Surendra. Engineer P. Chulani Perera, Chairman, Electrical and Electronics Engineering Sectional Committee. And Engineer Neela Besekara, myself. Kindly remain standing. I cordially invite the President of IESL to garland the photograph of late engineer DJ Vimal Surendra. Thank you very much. Please be seated. Dear President, Speaker Engineer Rienzi Fernando, Engineer Chulani Perera, Chairman, Electrical and Electronics Engineering Sectional Committee, you are kindly requested to proceed to the stage. Dear President, I kindly invite you to deliver the welcome speech.
Thank you, Engineer Neil. I would take this opportunity to warmly welcome you to the Engineer DJ Vimala Surendra Memorial Oration. And I feel it is my duty to tell you a little bit about Engineer Vimala Surendra, one of the greatest engineers of our time. Engineer Vimala Surendra, who introduced hydropower to Sri Lanka, was born on 17th September 1874. Actually, because of this date, the Engineering Council was also inaugurated ceremonially yesterday on his birthday. Okay. He studied at Ananda College, Colombo, and won awards for proficiency in practically all subjects. While in school, he passed the London matriculation examination and became the student to receive the prestigious D.B. Jayatilaka Memorial Award. Later, after obtaining his engineering qualifications, he joined the government factory as a trainee engineer, joined the engineering section of the Colombo Technical College and obtained a degree in civil engineering, and after he gained graduation from India, he was appointed the senior engineer in the public works department. As a district engineer, he rendered commendable service to the areas Diyathalava, Gaul and Udupuzhellavu in Kandy. Later, he was appointed as the chief engineer of public works, and once appointed to the post of deputy director, he designed the Kolumnava power distribution system. In a research project presented to Ceylon Engineering Association, he has presented about hydroelectric generation potential in Sri Lanka. In 1913, Engineer Vimala Surendra gave his thoughts in the construction of a small hydropower station at Blackpool between Nanoye and Noarelia to supply electricity to Noarelia town. In 1918, he submitted a project report titled Economics of Hydropower Utilization in Ceylon to the Engineering Association to make his dream come true. He estimated that the water potential combined with Muskeli and Kelgamoya could be diverted to produce electricity to light 100,000 lamps. Hence the name Lakshapan, easily read as Lakshapan. The idea was to feed power to the national grid. Finally, in 1923, the colonial government decided to go ahead with the production of hydropower, and the PWD was entrusted with the work. Yet Engineer Vimala Surendra was not taken into this project. So in 1931, after contesting and winning the state council election, Engineer Vimala Surendra paved way for the implementation of Lakshapan hydropower project. As a result, in 1950, the first hydropower project in Sri Lanka was started with a capacity of 25 megawatts. And during the renovation of Ruanvelisaya, Engineer Vimala Surendra also, in civil engineering area, designed the Kotkaral, the uppermost part of the stupa. And in order to inspire the West with Buddhist philosophy, translated many Buddhist books into German language. Engineer Vimala Surendra rendered creditable service to his motherland. Passed away on 10th of August 1953. In order to honor his incomparable service, the hydropower station at Northern Bridge was later named after him as DJ Vimal Surendra Hydropower Station. With that brief introduction, I would like to pave way for the guest speaker to begin his speech after the Executive Secretary introduces him. Thank you.
Thank you very much, President. Let me introduce Engineer Rian C. Fernando. Engineer Rian C. Fernando graduated from University of Moratuwa in 1979 with BSc Engineering degree, specialized in electrical engineering. After graduation, he was employed in Walker and Craig Limited in 1980 January as an engineer. He was employed in the Ceylon Electricity Board in 1982 February as an electrical engineer and was attached to Kalanithisa Power Station. During the tenure at CEB, he has participated 1 year technical training in Germany. He was promoted to the chief engineer grade in 1991. He also worked for Ministry of Power and Water in state of Qatar for 2 years from 1992 to 1994. On return, he served CEB as a chief engineer in transmission, maintenance and transmission design branches. He resigned from CEB in 2002 as a chief engineer and formed his own consulting company, Amiti Power Consultants, in 2002 April. To date, he is working as the managing director of the company. In the meantime, in his individual capacity, he has provided consultancy services for UNOPS in Jordan and for ADB in Papua New Guinea and in Vietnam and for private international companies like ADEA and EPC International of Australia in countries including India, China, Fiji. Further, he has directly worked for Iraqi Power Ministry for 1 year in Baghdad. Let me introduce what he is going to talk today. The abstract. The battery technologies are emerging very fast and applications in present context is considered very often as not feasible economically and financially. The presentation emphasizes possible applications. Many dialogues at present are seen in technical media are going on in connection with various types of applications. Use of large-scale battery applications on renewable power sector is already becoming popular. At present, pump storage versus battery storage is also a popular topic. Issues on system stability is still debatable with battery storage. Further, possible applications in industrial sector is discussed in presentation, such as emergency power and reduction of energy bills. Emergency power applications can be economical than emergency standby diesel generators. Applications of batteries in emergency situations in electrified railway can be attractive and sensible than standby generators. Dear Engineer Fernando, it is over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Abhishekar. Professors, President of IHL, and engineers, ladies and gentlemen. Today, I'm talking about, it's my great pleasure to deliver this lecture on applications of large-scale batteries for utilities and industrial purposes on this occasion. On this prestigious occasion. You know, on the same stage on CPD courses, I used to do a lot of athletics here and there around the stage. So today with the cloak and all, I thought I should behave better. Anyway, now coming back to the subject, sorry, I should address also the family members of Engineer Vibhul Surendra. And back to the subject matter, applications of large scale batteries for utilities and industrial purposes. Now, I am mainly talking about the lithium ion phosphate battery, which is a new technology, and flow batteries. And lead acid, nickel cadmium are okay conventional batteries used everywhere, and people know about it. And lithium ion batteries are now in the market, market share is for cars and various other applications, and for renewable energy applications and all are very common and popular. Now, all these conventional batteries has a performance decay with the shallow discharges or deep discharges. Now, this graph shows, okay, for 6000 or 2000 discharges, okay, cycles, the depth of discharge goes up to 40%. Now, some of the batteries are better, and they can do 6000 cycles, deep discharges or shallow discharges, and that means about 2-3 years or 4 years if you do the discharges daily and charging. So the performance of batteries are decaying. Now, implemented storage schemes based on technologies, okay, flywheel, the green one, and the supercapacitor, yellow one, and lead acid battery, again a beige, and superconducting magnetic energy storage, that is the red one, and sodium sulfur battery, that is also a very good battery for usage of large scale batteries, and flow battery is the latest technology. So I'm talking about that. This graph shows, okay, the megawatt, the power versus the energy, megawatt hours, which in the world which are implemented and running now. So this shows, okay, conventional batteries, lead acid, and can go up to 3000 ampere hour. So our car battery is okay, sometimes 40 ampere hour or 25 ampere hour, whatever the car size, that range. Now these batteries can go up to 3000 ampere hour, and here if you are using to discharge a deep discharge in 50 hours, 70 hours and 400 hours, the currents are given on the table. What is the current that you can use for discharging of the duration shown above? Now these batteries, except the flow battery, can discharge in hours or in minutes or in seconds. Now go for the last one, 1000 ampere hour battery. If you are discharging at 10 hours, it's 105 amperes, and then if you are discharging in 30 seconds, it's 1152. These are the manufacturer's data anyway. Now, if you try to discharge in 30 seconds, your battery terminals may get melted also, right? Now, okay, now the idea is the batteries, conventional batteries except the flow battery, can discharge its energy in durations that you like to discharge. Now the problem is, okay, now if you are connecting that battery to your grid or AC system, you have to have an inverter. The battery can discharge that much, but your inverter can't, right? So inverter, if you are designing for larger currents, then it's going to be not cost effective. Now this inverter response shows on the left hand side about the red curve shows the peak of about 12 amps, and it faces at the arrow, it faces a short circuit or higher current. Now what happens, the inverter within few seconds, okay, 2 seconds, it shuts off, because electronics of inverter junctions cannot handle that sort of energy. It itself, for from its protection, it would shut off. So general trip values of inverters by electronics for under voltage, 88%, time is 500 milliseconds, and yeah, under voltage 88% is 500 milliseconds, under voltage 50% is 30 milliseconds, instant overcurrent 125% within 5 milliseconds, and overcurrent 100 milliseconds. So this gives you some data of lithium ion phosphate batteries. Number one, charging power MVA 0.25, that can be adjusted okay with the electronics of charging, and discharge power MVA 1, right? Now this battery charges with 1767 kilowatt hours, and in number 5 it shows it can discharge 1455 kilowatt hours. That is about 80% of what you discharge. So the battery round trip efficiency is here about 80%. So okay, other data is here, the nominal output voltage and voltage range and frequency, whatever you use with the inverter, and the ambient temperatures that it can work for, and the altitudes and humidity and all that. Now this shows in number 18, round trip efficiency of the battery. They say site test conditions. The site test conditions is definitely the 20 degrees centigrade ambient temperature. At that ambient temperature, it can go up to 87.5%, almost 90% efficiency, round trip efficiency, right? And after 10 years, they say, okay, if they test the lithium ion phosphate battery at site test conditions that they specify, 20 degrees centigrade and all, it's again 86, dropped by about 1.5%. So it's a good this thing. And now you know, as I said in the previous one, in normal operation it's 80%, however it drops in normal temperatures what we working. Okay, 30 degrees it's less. Now flow batteries, world's safest, easiest to deploy, long duration energy storage, chemistry is basic and simple, no exotic materials or electrolyte, electrolyte is non-toxic, pH is similar to soda and wine, but you can't make it a substitute for wine because it's salt. And key breakthrough of this technology is managing the reaction to eliminate the carbon electrode degradation. So inherently safe, no fire risk, no special fire safety requirements for the transport or siting or whatever. Environmentally friendly, environmentally very friendly, because it's iron, salt and it doesn't use very complicated materials or whatever, and capable of tens of thousands of cycles with no loss of power or energy performance. Like the conventional batteries, as I showed you earlier, it has a decaying performance with the cycles. Now this doesn't have such a decay of performance, and for the time being these manufacturers guarantee this for similar performance going on and on for 25 years, but it has not been tested, that's it, for 25 years. Now for 12 years, yes, they have already tested, it's similar performance. They are not talking about okay site test conditions or 20 degrees or whatever, it can work on very diverse weather conditions and all. Containerized turnkey storage modules can be shipped dry anyway, anywhere, and 100% recyclable materials are used in that battery technology. So specifications available right now is maximum capacity 100 kilowatt, 400 kilowatt hours, and 400 kilowatt hours could be dispatched in 4 hours, they say, but it might be if you order 1 or 2 units, not 100 units, right? 1 or 2 units are available for the rack. Charging is flexible, could be charged in 4 hours or 5 hours. Round trip efficiency 50% to 80%, and you know, containers could be stacked over each other and use it, and if you use the doors on the sides of the containers, 1 megawatt battery plant need the space of 28 meter by 15 meter only, leaving the maintenance corridor. And you can even you know, if you are using the batteries indoor design, then you can contract the space that is required further. So this is for container stacking. So the chemistry is basic, simple, iron, salt, water, and I'm not the best one to talk about the chemistry. So if you ask what is Benning's chemistry given here and all that, and this has two electrodes, electrode A, electrode B, and both sides there are two pumps. And in between the flow battery, there is a membrane. So when manufacturing these membranes and the electrodes, are the, you know, the technological sort of secrets. Now, cycling performance. Now, red line gives you lithium ion cells which degrades with shallow cycling. Now, this is used to discharge 100% to 75% every day. Like, so after 6000 cycles, lithium ion drops to 70%. Now, shallow cycling of the flow batteries doesn't decay, it goes on and on and on. No performance decay at all. Now, these are for deep cycling, is the same thing, and for deep cycling also. Lithium ion cells, the performance degrades. That means if you charge 100%, you can, after 6000 cycle, you can get 75% out. Now I'm talking about the comparison of the capabilities of initially both batteries can do about 80%. So that particular 80% taking as 100%, this is compared. So modular design, you can see one side electrolyte tanks, positive and negative, then the blue section, and on the front side you have the panels with power electronics, balance of plant panels. So power electronics ventilation is on the front, and batteries are on the other side. Yeah, pumps and pump skids are in the middle. So this looks like one of the 100 kilowatt, 400 kilowatt hour battery. So this is one of the studies done for solar power plant. You know, the purple section is battery charging. So all together, the purple and the beige is the solar dispatch, and in the night you can do the battery dispatch. So it's right about say 3600 kilowatt hours with battery. So 24,000 kilowatt hours with the solar, and with the batteries 3600. You know, there are also the energy on the purple section is charged and then 80% of that is discharged in the night, and plant configuration, DC solar field is 7.5 megawatts and invert output is 6 megawatts, battery storage capacity 1.2 megawatts, peak hour battery dispatch 3.6 megawatt hours. That means okay, when we have the peak usage of the daily curve, at that time you are dispatching 3.6 megawatts and peak power output to grid 5 megawatts at maximum 1 megawatt power could be utilized with the battery. So here bidirectional inverter and battery pack and solar inverters and grid connection and all that are given in the plant configuration. Economic analysis and feasibility of that project is 13% IRR. That doesn't look like very encouraging, but I have used the maximum battery prices, and when you are using many batteries, you may get much attractive discounts, and if you evaluate with that, this may go up to about 16% IRR. So this is also analyzed for 100% loan and maximum prices for solar field and batteries. Mini grid applications approaching optimal battery energy storage systems for most economical and eco-friendly solution for small scale power systems. Some study aspects carried out for mini grid in Alatau in Papua New Guinea, where I have worked with ADB, with 3 megawatts peak power is given in following slides, and they are trying to get 2 megawatts for a smaller system. In that, high generation cost, stability issues, and restarting issues, and issues in spinning. Now, they are using only diesel generator and running on diesel, not even heavy fuel. So a small system of about 3.5 megawatts, 3 megawatts, and Papua New Guinea, you have small clusters, all the towns are electrified with such diesel plants. And only Port Moresby has a, Port Moresby and in the north also has a smaller grids with 132 kV and 66 kV. And except for those two areas, all the other towns are electrified with smaller diesel generators. So you can imagine at the time of Engineer Vimala Surendra, how Colombo has worked with diesel generators. I think the diesel generator station is still there with CB at foot, and that sort of situation could be observed if you go to these places in Papua New Guinea. So this is a single line diagram of that small system. I'll try to They have 600 kilowatt and 250 kilowatt generators running on a 11 kV bus and transformers, two transformers, transforming that to 22 kV and distributed to these two lines. And they have problems of tripping the system for 5 times a day and restarting. And for that, they also trying to put the renewable energy of 2 megawatt solar with batteries. So that has been studied, and simulation of Altaw PNG system with these generators. One generator is tripped over here, and it takes around 3 seconds to start the generator and develop the voltage at power frequency. Spinning diesel generator could be connected in around 200 milliseconds. Behavior of other generators and buses are monitored. These are the graphs for that. And behavior of other generators are this. And this is evolving towards inverter dominated power system. Now our current system is with high inertia, running with all these synchronous machines and so on, with coal power, hydro power, and we don't have nuclear power, and PV and wind very small amount. Now we are evolving towards low inertia system that is also called virtual inertia with inverters. So now SEBI is encouraging, you come with batteries and inverters with your renewables, the wind or solar, so that the fluctuations are cushioned out, and the frequency winds are very fast absorbed. Now I have this slide, multiple time frame frequency response in a power system in Altaw, of course. That is when there's a frequency event disturbance, some line goes off or something like that, trips off, or section of a line trips off or something like that, then for a frequency event the virtual inertia would respond very fast than the inertia system with the diesels. So this graph shows how it behaves. So we are slowly coming to utility applications. Unfortunately, I have here up to 2014 demand curves. So I just want to say, if you draw the line across, so that on the daytime or the off-peak time or whatever, where you have low loads, you are charging the battery, or you are using a pump storage to store energy, and above the line you can discharge that. So generally the areas that is between the curve and the line drawn are the possibility of charging, and above that is the possibility of dispatch whatever you have stored. So charging and dispatch plan for a 50 megawatt battery storage is considered, and the the blue section is charging and violet section is dispatch. Now it is dispatched during 4 hours between 18:30 to 22:30 and 23:30, you are starting 23 hours, you are starting the charging, and that goes up to 5 o'clock in the morning following day. This concept is to charge at off peak and discharge at peak hours. So tariff proposed for charging is I3 or I2, in which the demand charge and the energy charge, I3 energy charge is 685 and the demand charge is 685 per kilowatt hour, and demand charge is something like 1100 rupees per kVA. So the configuration for 50 megawatt, 137 numbers of 100 kilowatt, 400 kilowatt hours batteries has been studied. If the maximum demand charge shall be 52 million, somewhere around 52 million, and energy charge for the storage about 1.6 million per day, to charge 243,903 kilowatt hours, to dispatch 200,000 kilowatt hour per day, and for 30 days cycle the energy charge would be somewhere around 50.1 million. If monthly demand charge is waived off, right, then 200,000 kilowatt hours per day can be dispatched by 50 megawatt system at rupees 30 per units with commercial terms of IRR 10. Here also it is not very attractive because of the battery prices, but battery prices are reducing day by day. With demand goes up, the battery prices are now reducing. So advantages of utility, now generating 50 megawatts peaking plant at rupees 30 instead of conventional diesel gas turbine or whatever, running at 40 can be stopped. Now this can be, so the advantage is rupees 10, therefore the saving for 200 megawatt hours at peak time is 2 million, making a monthly profit of 60 million. So that would set off the demand charge. And it is obvious that off-peak generation around 1000 megawatt, or right now it's 1300 megawatt off-peak demand. And due to system restrictions and generating restrictions, 3 into 300 megawatt coal power plants would have to run on minimum loads like 180 megawatts. Right? Now, on the table below, it's given the thermal rates, the heat rates of the coal plants. And if you are running at 300 megawatts, it's 2038 BTU per kilowatt hour. And if you are running at 180, it's 2147. So the saving there may not be much. Now, if you calculate the saving by producing the units at high efficiency at 300 megawatts, the saving could be per month only 3 million rupees. That is nothing much. So, advantages to utility continued. You can delay and avoid inefficient peaking plants, giving an advantage enormously on the investment and on environmental issues as well. If a peaking power plant of 50 megawatt is installed, minimum investment can be 40 million US dollars, which the monthly loan premium shall be around rupees 39 million for a soft loan with total interest of 3% and duration of 20 years. So it is also supports the steady state stability, may be considered to replace the pump storage. Instead of pump storage, you can have the batteries, but you have certain problems with the batteries. It may also support transient stability. If the banks are installed distributed, example 50 megawatt battery banks in 10 substations instead of 50 megawatt in 500 megawatts in one place, it might support, but studies has to be done regarding that. Nobody has conducted such studies as it. Comparison of advantages and disadvantages of pump storage and battery storage. Now, pump storage to be designed for future and to be built suitable for certain project horizon. So, if you need the pump storage 1400 megawatts in maybe 2030 or 40, you have to build a system at that. Okay, your machinery can be added stage by stage, and the storage capacity has to be built. Large extent of land would be utilized for the pump storage, and in one location 50 megawatt batteries would need 20 to 25 acres if you spread the containers along the land. Okay, if you stack on one over the other, then you can contract the requirement of the land. Pump storage would need 3 to 4 years of installation time, whereas battery system can be installed in 100 days. Now, that reminds me, when a new government comes, if they want to do a 100-day plan, is the project. Pump hydro is based on well-established synchronous generation, providing critical ancillary services to the grid. Pump storage would give the ancillary services to the grid, that is provision of inertia and frequency and voltage support and sufficient fault level, which batteries fully can't give. But remember, still we are evolving from high inertia systems to virtual inertia system. So engineers may have to work on that very fast, and you have to work hard on that. Comparison of advantage and disadvantages continued. Battery inverter technologies are still catching up on the most of these fronts. The potential for batteries to provide synthetic inertia, or you call it synthetic inertia or virtual inertia, of fast frequency response high, but is balanced by the reliance on the system strength to be able to deliver the support, and they offer minimal support with the fault levels, but still can provide some support to the system frequency and voltage regulation. Cost of pump storage is 36 rupees per unit, maximum can be rupees 46 per unit considering the demand charge, but in generation plan they have given something like 15 rupees. I think that has been given without considering the demand charge. Battery costs may be higher with present context of replacement, and considering the capital cost, still without demand charge for batteries, battery unit cost. I mean, if you are using the battery, the unit cost may be higher. Capital cost for lithium ion batteries, phosphate battery, iron four batteries, and the pump storage. Lithium ion batteries, these are actually lithium ion phosphate batteries, at $700 per kilowatt and $500 per kilowatt hour. So that is with the battery, 1 megawatt, 1.455 megawatt hour, cost $ about 700,000. And flow batteries, $1,800 per kilowatt and $450 per kilowatt hour. 1 megawatt, that is with 1 megawatt, 4 megawatt hour battery, that costs $ about 1.8 million. Sorry, 1 megawatt, 1.8 million. Yeah. The pump storage costs extracted from generation plan for 600 MVA plant, what CBS plan is $1,261, and there is a recent study that gives a study for 1,400 megawatts that gives a cost of $800 per kilowatt. So we are coming to industrial applications. It is feasible to use batteries as an emergency power supply and use a storage to reduce the electricity bills in time of day tariff economically. It is also feasible to use batteries with limited flexibility to operate electrified train movements in light railway transport system. Why not on heavy railway also? So, case study, a factory. Working day, now the blue line, factory normal power and power consumption with lithium ion batteries and power consumption with ion flow batteries is the gray line. So what happens is, okay, the charging goes on off peak and it discharges during the day with CB power. So what happens? The demand charge goes down and the energy what you are using is 75% of whatever is 685 rupees divided by 75% is the energy charge. So CB might not okay, CB distribution might not like it, but CB generation would like it. So charging category I2 tariff, peak rupees 20 50 per kilowatt hour, daytime 11 per kilowatt hour, and off peak 685 per kilowatt hour. So the maximum demand charge is 110. This is what I have told you about the previous slide. Saving per month approximately with ion flow batteries is encouraging, but with present pricing of batteries it goes up to 8 years of simple payback. Right, so in years to come, it's definitely when the battery prices goes down, this would be feasible and ideal for the island mini grids. So similar opportunity in domestic installation with small scale batteries. CB has introduced them. Time of day tariff for domestic consumption consumers, and day is 13 rupees, peak is 54, and off peak is 25. So what do you do? Let's charge at daytime. So it's exactly that, and you know. In number 2 table, energy usage per day. Now as usual, number 1 and 2 over there, air conditioner 12,000 BTU, air conditioners 9,000 BTU, consumes number of hours and the units consumed are more than 70% of the total usage, right? And number 3, energy usage based on time of the day, 9.67 units, off peak day 15.14, and units used per day 35, and its bill is for that 29,000. So if you do the little bit of energy charged over daytime and discharge at other time, you know, he can easily, okay, now instead of off peak here 140 units, that is with the charging, and day 754 units against 454, and peak 158 because you are using the charge energy during the day. Now his bill goes down to 21, that is about 30% saving. That is domestic, and these systems are available in Sri Lanka, developed by a local company. So even you have solar with batteries, right? If you discharge that during the peak time, remember, you are getting paid of 54 rupees a unit. What I mean is, okay, during the day you charge the batteries and you discharge at the peak time, then against the what CEB pays 16 rupees, this is going to be 54 rupees a unit. Okay, as an emergency power plant, can be used as an emergency power plant instead of a generator. If so, how do you evaluate that? Now, you install a generator and you sit on that investment until you get a power failure. So, with the number of power failures only, you are, your money back is coming, right? So, if you evaluate with that sense of mind, okay, these things are definitely feasible. So, little bit of LRT, this is how it's going to be over Castle Street after Kota Road Ayurveda Junction, and two cabin railway, two cabin locomotives are running up and down, and 22 trains. See the fourth bullet. 22 trains are on the track, and each 1.9 megawatts. So, 7 trains are accelerating. That takes maximum power. 0.9 megawatts, and 8 trains will consume half power because they are running at a constant speed before decelerating, and another 8 trains are trying to stop, and either they are consuming no power or they are regenerating. So, the LRT system designed from Petah to Malanpet will have 22 trains at the peak time, kept running at peak times, passing a station every 3 to 5 minutes, and would be stopped at station. There are about 15 stations along that 25 kilometers up to Malanpet, and on each station it has to stop at least 2 minutes for passengers to get down and other passengers to get in, and so this would require about 10 megawatts at the peak time. Traction power, DC, 800 volts DC, and okay, now if you are using a generating station as the emergency power, when power goes off, what happens? You have to sit on that or you have to get permission from CB to run that power plant, maybe without a profit, because the diesel is going to be very heavily cost heavily, and you can't do that. But this is a feasible solution, and still we are doing the studies according to that, and the problem is okay. Nobody knows still how to model these things, and yeah, those problems are there. But E-Trax and Power World and various other software, real time, could be used to do this, and some experts are working on that to study how we can use battery banks for emergency power. And if you are using these batteries, you can also run for 4 hours until the power comes. And also now towards the end of the day, you can discharge that, so you automatically get the return. Now, as in previous exercise, you can discharge that for normal train running before charging for the next day. So with that you can get the return. No sound pollution like in diesel generators. So this is an easy solution. And also now they have planned their converter stations. There will be 8 converter stations along the route that converts the 3 kV and LV and 800 volts DC converter to supply the trains. Now this converter station, if they are putting every other equipment inside the building, they need about 28 by 15 meters space, 28 meters by 15 meters space. Now if they are putting the batteries on next 2 floors, you can have 1 megawatt over there. So 8 megawatts could be placed on the converter stations itself. So indoor area requirement, this is what I have told you about, having all 2 megawatts perhaps on the stations would make you up to 16 megawatts. Okay, synopsis is the with emerging battery technologies, above aspects has been discussed are becoming feasible, not yet feasible. And it is the evolution from high inertia systems to virtual inertia systems with the non-dispatchable renewables like wind, solar generations are becoming popular, and engineers are there to tell you when the politicians say I want this. So engineers are there to say how to do it. So most often we say no, this cannot be done. So I am saying for this, don't say no. So we have to work on that. So without saying no to new introductions like inverter dominated power systems, let's work on it. Okay gentlemen, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fernando, for your resourceful speech. Hope the audience would have got a good insight into the use of batteries in renewable power sector, and probably food for thoughts of our CV engineers. Now I call upon President Professor Pallavath to give away the token of appreciation to Engineer Rian C. Fernando. Thank you very much, Mr. Now it's time to deliver the vote of thanks. I call invite Engineer Cholani Perra, the Chairman, Electrical and Electronic Engineering Sectional Committee.
Thank you, Engineer Nee. President, Professor Pallavath, past presidents, council members, and all other members, sectional committee members. It is indeed a great pleasure to introduce a new technology by kissing. The members of the late engineer Vimalasir and the family. In fact, when the sectional committee discussed, this is a annual event. When we discussed this issue, so we had various options to be invited, and I thought it is better to invite another friend of mine. He readily accepted our request without any hesitation, and I think he prepared this presentation for maybe nearly 2 months. It's appreciated your listening, and thank you very much, everybody. Thank you.